restoring vision for retinal degeneration. How the use of optogenetics can restore vision to the visually impaired. José-Alain Sahel, University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine, Institut de la Vision, Sorbonne Université. On November 9, 1989, I was at my home in Strasbourg and kept thinking of the significance of the event for the future.
Well, thank you very much. Difficult to follow you, so I'll try to be not disappointing. It's a big honor for me to be here today, and I didn't realize the impact it would have on me, remembering many things. So you mentioned also Dr. Lee. Dr. Lee was an ophthalmologist, and he passed away after telling about this virus almost 2 years ago. The work I'm going to present to you is the work of many people. And especially I want to mention Botton Rosca in Basel. We have been working together on that for 15 years. Any breakthrough takes, for me, 15 and 25 years. And my collaborators, Serge Picot and Denise Delcara, but also many other people that have been part of that, including industry. Almost two centuries, 250 years ago, the French philosopher Denis Diderot wrote a letter that brought him to jail, actually to Vincennes in jail. It was a letter on the blind, and he was trying to discuss this concept of regaining vision and also what we can learn from the blind. He was referring to this idea that we believe that the truth is something we can touch or something we can see. For the blind, they have to touch. For us, we have to see, and we believe that what we see is the truth. The question that was raised in his letter was a question that was actually addressed to the philosopher John Locke a few years before by a neurophysiologist called Molineux. The question would be, in case someone who has been blind and was able to recognize the shapes by touching them is regaining vision, does he have to learn how to see? Or is this vision could be going to be like automatically transmitted to the brain just through the eyes? Recognizing a sphere versus a cube, for example, is this a possibility? This question has been at the core of many philosophical discussions for 200 years and more, and is still unsolved. But as scientists working on vision restoration, we are confronted to that. And I want to tell you about the journey of a patient and the journey of scientists and technologists trying to address this specific question. The question is the question that was really impacting this person. This man was affected with a disease called retinitis pigmentosa. It's the most frequent genetic disease that leads to blindness. And he heard about it when he was a teenager. And eventually, over the course of almost 40 years, he lost totally vision and had been blind for 50 years. So he will speak a couple of times during this speech.
J'avais sans doute une rétinopathie, une rétinite pigmentaire. Mais à un moment, je me suis quand même retrouvé sur les rails du métro. Et là, j'ai un médecin qui m'a dit, bah, écoute, tu vas t'arrêter, je vais t'arrêter de bosser parce que tu vas te tuer. Ah. Et voilà, et de ce jour-là, j'étais en vacances.
So this person had been blind for 15 years when he entered this clinical trial. This clinical trial was really trying to address the need for him to restore some level of vision. And it's using a technology that is really trying to, I hope the movie will play, to replace the photoreceptors. When we see, the light is entering the eye through the pupil and is reaching the photoreceptors at the depth of the retina that absorb the light, convert that into electrical signal that is processed in the retina as a neural tissue and gets transmitted through the optic nerve to the brain. And the brain is the place where we see. The images are formed and really are processed into the brain. In retinitis pigmentosa, the photoreceptors are dying. And because they are dying, there is no ability to capture the light and no ability to transform the light into electrical signal, which means that there is no information to give to the brain, and this is blindness. So the question is, how can we replace photoreceptors? There are many approaches to that, but the one I'm going to talk today is called optogenetics. Optogenetics was actually discovered almost more than 30 years ago by a German scientist, namely Pete Hegemann. He was here yesterday for the science meeting at the charity symposium. Hans Bamberg, George Nagel, and Osterhout. And it's something that does exist in algae. This is the typical discovery in science that nobody thinks is useful in anything. Algae are getting toward the light because they are harboring at the surface a specific protein that carries both a channel and a chromophore, which means they can absorb the light and convert the light into a signal. And this is prompting the algae to get toward the light through flagelli. This mechanism is in one protein recapitulating what we have in the human retina and mammalian retina, where hundreds of proteins are absorbing the light, transforming the signal into an electrical signal that is amplified by 1 million. So why do we need something so complex? It's because we need to adapt to many levels of light and because we have much higher resolution than algae. But anyway, this specific protein could be used to stimulate neurons or any cells. And the idea came, obviously, to many people to use that in neuroscience. And this is what happened, for example, with Carl Desrot and Ed Boyden. But a few people like us thought that maybe this could be applied to restore vision by replacing photoreceptors. So our goal was to transfect to using gene therapy remaining cells in the retina. And we tried all these cell types, so we have been working on in parallel to all these approaches. But what I'm going to mention today is targeting the cells that are remaining in even advanced stages of retinitis pigmentosa, the ganglion cells, the cells that are forming the optic nerve. So through many steps, we worked on how to deliver the gene to the retina and what protein to use. And we ended up with this combination therapy that is a combination of a vector that carries the gene coding for the protein for this very specific optogenetic protein that is expressed in the ganglion cells and coupled with a medical device that I will discuss in a moment. We had to find the light that is necessary. The initial proteins that were discovered by the scientist need a huge amount of light to be activated. And this amount of light would be impossible to use in humans because it would be toxic to the retina. So we had to find a way to shift that into something that would be safe. And we tried many of them, and eventually identified one called Crimson R that was developed at MIT by Ed Boyden, that was really fitting what we needed, being shifted into the red, which is far less energetic, and needing an amount of light which is perfectly safe. So we tested that in many animal models and eventually moved that to the clinical trial. So how does it work? The protein is expressed at the level of the ganglion cells and the ambient light doesn't work, doesn't trigger anything. But if you use a very highly activated amount of light, then you are able to activate these proteins. And these proteins are eliciting a signal. And this signal is resulting from the fact that the goggles that I will show you in a moment are really able to stimulate the retina with enough levels of light. So these goggles have a camera in front of them. And these cameras I will describe to you. And they are sending the information. And then the brain has to learn how to see, because this type of information is not a natural type of information. So the therapy we developed is a combination of a gene therapy and a medical device to be able to activate that. So we have to learn how the retina sees. The retina is speaking a very specific language. And for example, these three shapes, this is, for example, the sphere that Molino was asking about. This is the cube. And each of them has a specific signature. So how does it work? The retina is detecting any change at the nanosecond. And any change is really a microsecond. And any change is really eliciting a specific signal. Because of this approach, which is more or less event-based, any change is eliciting a signal, we try to use a system that would mimic that. And for that, we use a type of camera that was at the front of the goggles that the patient is using. And this processing leads to a signal that is emitted at the back of the goggles towards the eye. So I will show you how these cameras work. Hopefully it will work, not sure it will. So if you want to turn down the light, and we'll see this camera. So this camera is detecting me when I am moving. If I am not moving, I'll stay still, I'm going to disappear. If I'm moving again, this is creating a signal, and this signal is the one that the retina is using. Interestingly, when we take pictures, and you can bring back the light if you want, when we take pictures, you can bring back the light if you want, we are using a lot of information that is useless because nothing is moving except a small part of the scenery we are looking at. So the goal is to send to the eye only the information that is useful, namely the change. And this is what these cameras are doing. They are specifically coding for the change. They send a light which is in the amber spectrum that corresponds to the absorption by the retina. So how does it work for the patient? The signal is then transmitted to the brain, and then there is a long process that took several months for the patient to learn how to interpret these images. It's partial restoration, and I'll show you in real time what happened with the patient that was trained through that. And this is what this movie is going to show you if it plays. Sorry, I have to go back. So can you play the movie? Or maybe it's going to play, hopefully. Not that one, the one on the slide, sorry. So, okay. So normally you would see the patient who doesn't... So can you back? Can you go back to the... Okay, we are really not doing well. Okay, so this movie should play, if you can have it play. Okay, so this is without the goggles, and the patient is trying to screen, so he doesn't, he has the gene therapy, but he doesn't have a goggle, so he's trying to screen the table to find if there is any object. Doesn't see anything. Now with the goggles, and he is now scanning again the table, and on this computer, this is what the camera is projecting onto the eye, and the patient is scanning that, so it's a real-time activity, and so at some point he will be able to align. Now we have improved. Okay, so he's detecting something which is.
Qui me paraît pas être le. Non, c'est ni un bord ni le haut, puisque ça me donne le sentiment d'avoir une espèce de vibration un peu verticale. Oups. Là, c'est très blanc. J'ai un truc qui vibre verticalement.
Okay, so he's detecting that. So what does it mean for the patient? He's now able to count objects. He's able to see the stripes that came across the street. And I'm going to report at the end of the week at the American Academy on other patients in this trial. So going back to the Diderot discussion, we have to see, but when we see, actually we are learning how to see as kids, but we don't know about it. And the blind have to learn how to make sense of what they see. And really they have to confront the inner vision they had before, which was really through touch, to the vision they are getting back through this new perception. Many years ago, Michel Foucault, talking about the birth of a clinic, was mentioning that we tend to equate the truth and the vision. But the truth is something that needs naivety of gaze, something which is totally new, and this is the type of new vision that people are regaining. But this equation between the truth and the vision is something we use every day in every life, and we tend to believe that vision is everything. It's very important, and it's a major thing. Actually, when Diderot spoke about that, about the truth and about the impairment, he was brought to jail. And this is a connection, I think, to what we are seeing today. There are many voices, many aspects of truth, many visions that are very different, many types of naivetes. And this is, for me, what we call a society. And at some point, there is a need for the vision of both sides to come across to each other. An important aspect of the research we do is to try to restore some level of vision, which is more or less transforming blind patients into visually impaired patients. But visually impaired patients are still facing a society that is not prepared to take care of them. And something we have to learn is that the society has to be inclusive enough so that people that are either blind or visually impaired or any type of impairment can have an easier journey towards autonomy and not just thinking of them as handicapped people, but autonomous people. And we need to really pair what is scientific innovation with societal transformation. And this is still a lot of work we have to do. This event is an amazing event because it probably gives some clues about how having a dialogue with society could help us to bring more to our patient. I'll give the last word to our patient.
Pour quelqu'un qui, comme moi, avait fait le deuil de sa vue, si j'ose dire, c'est quand même un truc assez extraordinaire, à un moment, de se dire, ben voilà, je revois. Voilà, c'est plein d'espoir.
Thank you very much.